is Justification by Faith Alone. Now, that's a pretty bland title, but it is an absolutely essential truth that we must grasp hold of. This is a Bible conference, and we've called it a Bible conference, and yet it's a very theological topic. But theology that is not based clearly on Scripture is worthless. So, we're going to be using our Bibles. I know that because Dr. Smith is one of my professors in seminary. And I know his love for the Scriptures. I remember, let me tell it one more time. Scott Simmons came in late to class. Dr. Smith begins his classes with a devotion, opening of Scripture and reading Scripture. Scott came in late. He had a habit of sauntering into class. And Dr. Smith stopped and said, "You're interrupted the reading of the inerrant Word of God." And without any anger, malice, or anything, he gave us a clear understanding of our need to pay attention to the Holy Word of God that was seared with great fear in my soul. So I praise God for godly men who taught me the Word of God and encouraged me in the Scriptures. Our evening's topic is justification in the Old Testament with regard to Adam and Abraham. Reverend Dr. Morton H. Smith is professor of systematic theology and biblical theology at Greenville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. He holds a bachelor's degree from the University of Michigan in forestry, his first theological degree from Columbia Theological Seminary, and his doctor's degree from the Free University of Amsterdam. He has done graduate studies at the University of Michigan and at Westminster Theological Seminary. He pastored the Springfield and Roller Presbyterian Churches in Carroll County, Maryland, and he was professor of Bible and chairman of the Department of Bible at Belhaven College in Jackson, Mississippi, and a guest lecturer at Westminster Theological Seminary, a professor of theology, one of the founding professors at Reformed Theological Seminary, when it was first called the Reformed Theological Institute, and a professor and chairman of the Department of Systematic Theology at Reformed Theological Seminary in Jackson, Mississippi from 1966 to 1979. Been a guest lecturer of Systematic Theology and English Bible and Apologetic at Covenant Theological Seminary in St. Louis. And he was the first stated clerk of our denomination. Dr. Smith is a founder of the Presbyterian Church in America, one of the men who pioneered our denomination. He is the author of Studies in Southern Presbyterian Theology, and the book that really made an enormous impact on many people in the late 60s, early 70s, How Is the Gold Become Dim, a book that defined the issues in the old Southern Presbyterian Church and turned hearts to the right in more ways than one. And he is also the author of a book called Testimony, which is an overview of Reformed theology in a popular fashion. He is the author of The Harmony of the Westminster Confession of Faith and Catechisms. He's also got a commentary that our session uses on a regular basis on the Book of Church Order of the Presbyterian Church in America. He has written a book, The Case for Full Subscription to the Westminster Standards in the Presbyterian Church in America, and a three-volume tome in systematic theology, along with being a contributor to a dozen or more different theological journals and books on theology. Dr. Smith is more than a theologian. He is a man with a heart for God. And it's my privilege to introduce him to you this evening. Welcome with me, Dr. Smith.
Thank you. Thank you for that very gracious introduction. It's good to be back here with you all. I look forward to this time with you. I can remember times early when Wayne Buchtel was still here, coming and visiting the church, I think on at least two different occasions with him. And then I've been here a time or two since Henry's been here, at least twice before, haven't I? Mm-hmm. And I look forward to coming and being with you and getting reacquainted with you again. As suggested, my usual practice, and you know where I picked up this, was when Nigel Lee came and was a guest lecturer at Reformed Seminary. He always opened every class with a reading of Scripture, and I've made that my practice ever since that time. And so let me read just a couple of verses from the first chapter of Romans, and then we'll talk a little bit about the historical use of this in the Reformation. This is verses 16 and 17. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and to the Greek. For therein is revealed a righteousness of God from faith unto faith, as it is written, but the righteous shall live by faith. And we're at the season of the year when we do remember the Reformation. You're going to have a Reformation party tomorrow night, and this is our Reformation party for the adults to think about Luther. Luther, of course, was striving for satisfaction, assurance of salvation. And he turned from going to the law to the priesthood and was in the monastery. And as he came there, he rediscovered the Bible. And with the rediscovering of the Bible, he rediscovered the gospel. He was particularly stimulated with regard to the nailing of the theses, the 95 theses on the door at the Wittenberg church on the eve of All Saints Day. That would be the 31st of October, which is where we get the All Hallows Eve, and Halloween comes out of that. But on the eve of All Saints Day, John Tetzel, who was there in Germany trying to raise money for the building of St. Peter's in Rome, the present St. Peter's Cathedral that is there in the Vatican. He was trying to raise money for it, and he was selling indulgences by which he would say that if you give the action, well, one of his little poems and little sayings was, when you hear the coin drop, a soul from purgatory goes up. But one of the things that one of his members, Luther's members, provoked him with is that he had bought an indulgence from Tetzel, and he said, I don't have to confess sin about this. I have an indulgence. I can do it. And that so angered Martin Luther that he then proposed these theses with the hope of reforming the church. But one of the particular notes that he set forth, of course, is that justification is by faith alone. And this is, of course, the reason that we're looking at this at this particular season, to remember the Reformation and the fact of this great doctrine, justification by faith alone. Now, if you want to, you don't have to do this, but I think it's 871 in your hymn books, the definition of what is justification, before we begin to look at the scripture, what is justification? Shorter Catechism, question 33. Justification is an act of God's free grace. So one of the first things that our confession or our standards say, that it is an act, not a work. Now, sanctification is a work. Sanctification is God's making us more and more holy. Begins with the rebirth and continues throughout this life. It's a process. Whereas justification is an act. Now notice the things that are included in this act as defined in the Catechism. It's an act of God's free grace wherein he pardoneth all of our sins. So the pardon of sin. And then along with that, The other thing, and not all people who hold to this Protestant doctrine of justification by faith would add the second point. Many just stop with the pardon of sin. But the other thing that we believe is biblical as well, and accepteth us as righteous in his sight. So two things we see as involved in this, the pardon of sin and the acceptance of us as righteous. I'll just abbreviate righteous. Accepteth us as righteous in his sight. And then one other thing to be noted with regard to this, and I think this is one of the problems that is arising today in some of the controversy over justification. Not everybody understands this. God, before he can do this, has to be able to do it with integrity and honesty. How can he say, here I stand as a sinner before the judge? And how can he say, I forgive him and I accept him as righteous in my sight? And it's because he constitutes us that way. Constitutes us as righteous. How? By imputing to us the righteousness of Christ. So what is called the constitutive act. And it is an act, again, not a work. Is this matter of the imputation of the righteousness of Christ. Again, I'll abbreviate Christ with the chi. Imputation of the righteousness of Christ. And how is it received? By faith alone. So there you have the basic definition of justification as we understand it in our standards. And I think as we get into our biblical studies of this conference, we'll see what's involved. Now, you'll notice that I have entitled this, the first of all, justification of Adam. Before Adam was a sinner, there would be no necessity of his being pardoned, but he could simply be declared righteous by God. Prior to his fall, God could at any point have said, he's righteous, and he would be righteous before God because he was without sin, had not disobeyed God. It's interesting again, and here you don't have in your hymn books the larger catechism as it talks about the creation of man and the fact of the what are called I'm trying to come up with the right term. Not mandates so much, but rather the fact that these are creation ordinances. And the creation ordinances are found in the larger catechism. You may want to make reference to this. Question 20. What was the providence of God toward man in the estate in which he was created? Providence of God towards man in the estate in which he was created was the placing of him in paradise. First thing then that man had as God made him. And as you look at the Genesis 2 account where you have the specifics with regard to the creation of man beginning with verse 7. Jehovah God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And made man, and man became a living soul. And Jehovah God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And so the first of the creation ordinances is that he was placed in this garden. And further, along with that, he was to dress the garden. As you read on in verse 15, chapter 2 of Genesis, verse 15, Jehovah God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And so as you think about those creation ordinances, one of the first things that you have is the fact that he was given a task, labor. We tend to think of labor as part of the curse. Labor is not part of the curse. Man was made in the image of God to be active. God is active. God's a thinking one, thinking being. And God is active, and even in paradise, when we go there on in the future, we're going to continue to be active. And so the idea of labor is not anything that is wrong or is part of the curse, but man was given that a task to do, to tend the garden. He was put into the garden to dress it and to keep it. So the catechism question says he was placing him in the paradise, appointing him to dress it, and giving him liberty to eat of the fruit of the earth. And you have that back in chapter 1, where it says, verse 29 of chapter 1, God said, "Behold, I have given you every herb-yielding seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed to you, it shall be for food." And so God gave, in a sense, man the dominion over the earth. And he had the privilege of eating all of the food of fruits and vegetables. Matter of eating of flesh isn't actually given to him until after the flood. And then the eating of flesh is also added to that. We're not to eat the blood, but we may eat the flesh. And so that has continued since the flood. And it's, in a sense, the second new order of mankind after the flood. But the original condition then was he's given liberty to eat of the fruit of the earth, putting the creatures under his dominion. And you have then, of course, the fact that he was given that dominion over all the creatures of the earth that as he was made. Verse 27 of chapter 1, God created the man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the seas and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." You folks who are here working in the lab are really exercising human dominion over the matters of the earth as you learn how to use what the laws of nature are in various different aspects. That's exercising dominion over the earth. We continue to do that. We're still under that command, as it were. And so that dominion that was given to man at the very beginning was to be used to the glory of God in subduing the earth. So he was putting the creatures under his dominion and ordaining marriage. And notice that he is to be fruitful and multiply. Marriage was part of the creation ordinances, particularly thinking of the particular marriage was part of it, particularly social institutions, labor, marriage. Both of those given to man in his original condition prior to the fall. And this was to tell us how to live together and the proper relationships of family and so forth are involved in that. And you have the fuller account of that in the end of the second chapter with the creation of the woman and her being given to the man and then speaking about leaving his father and mother and cleaving to his wife. So that you have the marriage relationship outlined there. And then the other institution that I would mention as well, ordaining of marriage for his help and affording him communion with himself. Instituting the Sabbath, entering into a covenant of life. And so the Sabbath would be the next of the social institutions. That goes all the way back to creation. God rested from his labors of creation, and he set the pattern to institute the Sabbath for man. And as you read, particularly in the Isaiah description of the Sabbath in chapter 58 of the last two verses of that chapter, make the Sabbath a delight. Delight in the Lord. Spend this day with the Lord, not doing your own pleasures, not seeking your own work, but rather rejoicing in the Lord. That God is asking us to give him one day every week in which we come aside from all our regular cares, even our recreations, and spend it with him. Worship, certainly part of it, corporate worship, but private worship, devotions, family life together, talking about these things. None of us keep it perfectly, but it is something that was given to Adam prior to the fall. And something that, therefore, it's interesting, it doesn't wait for the Ten Commandments to be given, but it was already there. entering a covenant of life with him upon condition of personal, perfect, and perpetual obedience. And there we get to the probation and the matter of the life, of which the tree of life was a pledge and forbidding to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil upon the pain of death. So the larger catechism speaks of that covenant as a covenant of life. The confession speaks of it as being a covenant of works. And also the larger catechism in the next question, or question 30, speaks of it as a covenant of works. Covenant of works being obedience. A perfect obedience is described in this question 20 that we've just read of the larger catechism as perfect obedience, perfect, perpetual obedience that's required of man. There's a very real sense in which we're still under that covenant. It's not that any of us can earn any salvation with that, but that's what's required of us. And that's what Jesus came to do for us. When we fell into sin, God has provided a Savior who has come to keep the covenant and keep the obedience perfectly, obeyed perfectly throughout his life, and then paid the penalty for our breaking it. And it's all given to us by grace and received by faith alone. Now, going back to Adam and thinking about him prior to the fall, I would say his justification would be God's declaring of him as righteous, accepting of us as righteous in his sight. Adam, at any point, could be declared to be righteous as long as he had not disobeyed. All that time that he lived, however long it was, whether it was a day, part of a day, or a week, we don't know how long that period was prior to his fall. But as long as he was obedient, he could be declared to be righteous. And there are those who don't like the idea of, in a sense, Adam having God in any obligation to himself. So they don't like the idea of the covenant of works. There are Presbyterian ministers, even in the PCA, who take exception to this part of the standards. Say they don't believe in the covenant of works. I think it's pretty clear as you analyze, and if I can take this off and we go on and talk about this next step, pretty clear that what you have in this probation that God placed Adam under, that what we would call it in terms of a covenant, covenant of works being perfect obedience required. You have the parties of the covenant, and that would be God, and man or Adam representing the whole of the human race, the federal head of the race. And that God and Adam, you see, are in this covenantal relationship. The condition of the covenant, perfect obedience. The threat, if he breaks it, death. Day that thou dost eat thereof, thou shalt surely die. By implication, though it is not specifically said in the text, by implication the promise is, if you don't break it, then you will have life. Now, it isn't that he didn't already have life, but it would be life confirmed in righteousness. Eternal life, if confirmed in righteousness. As long as he was obedient, he was already living, already in obedience. Now, those who don't like the idea of God being in obligation to man, the covenant of works, I can, as it were, say, I've done this, God, now you owe me this. Well, I think you can say that on this basis. God has personally bound himself to that. There is a doctoral dissertation, Peter Lilback, who's new president at Westminster Seminary, has called his book, The Binding of God. He's talking about the covenants. And he's talking about the fact that God has voluntarily, as it were, bound himself to his creature, that if you will do this, then this will be your result. And so I think it is not in the ultimate sense of the creature being able to hold the mighty God into some sort of subjection to himself, but God has voluntarily said, if you will do this, I will do this. And in that sense, it is a covenant of works by which Adam would have earned that position as he moved forward in this matter, had he kept the covenant. Now let's just look at the terms of the covenant. Jehovah commanded man, saying, of every tree, verse 16, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And so here you have this language then speaking in these terms. The condition, you're not to eat of this tree, and the day that you do eat, if you do it, you will die. Now, I sometimes suggest with regard to the trees, if you think about the trees in the Garden of Eden, it's not as though you had a bunch of little trees and one tall one that that's different and therefore we won't go to that tree. The thing that makes this tree different is God's word. God said not to touch it, not to eat of it. It isn't anything else. It isn't that this tree looked different from the other trees. It isn't that this tree had anything that would scare them off, as it were. But God's word is the thing that the test is about, you see. It's the question, will Adam obey God because God is God? In a very real sense, that's the test that Satan asked about Job. Will Job really obey you, God, because you're God? Or doesn't he not obey you because you reward him so much? And that's the test that Adam was faced with. Will he obey because God has said it? The sovereignty of God is there. And the creature's one obligation is to hear his God and to voluntarily to subject himself and say, yes, I will obey. Now, as you read the account of the temptation, Satan, of course, comes not to Adam, but to Eve. It's interesting. She knows the full terms. She adds a little bit to them, not even to touch it. She says not to eat of it, but not even to touch it, as though maybe that's unreasonable. And by the way, that's a suggestion. I don't think she's yet sinning in that point. But a person who will today forbid what God permits will tomorrow permit what God forbids. And that's what you begin to see with Eve. She's forbidding what God permits. He didn't say you can't touch that tree. They could have climbed the tree for that matter if they'd wanted to. Just don't eat of it. That was the one thing required. And so you have Satan coming. And notice his opening remark to her. Has God said? It's that question, and he knows that that's the issue. Has God said this? And will you obey? And he suggests it's unreasonable. Has God not given you all the trees? Look, God could have said, Adam, this is your tree. There's enough fruit on it to feed you from now on. All the rest of the trees are mine. God could have made it that way. But what does he do? He gives him all the rest of the trees. And he says, with the one exception, I've asked you not to eat of that one tree, or commanded you not to eat of that one tree. And Adam is put under that test. Now, I think the testing period is a testing period that would be short. Had Adam, for example, had he kept it the first day, I don't think he would have been put under that same test and temptation the next day. Or had he kept it down to the 21st century, that he would still be under that temptation, that he might fall now. I think the test, had he obeyed it the first time, then he would have passed the test and he would have been confirmed in righteousness from that time on. Now that's not specifically said, but I think you see the implications of if it's a perpetual test that's there on and on and on, there's no assurance that he's actually gained his eternal life and righteous life confirmed to him. And so Adam, as you know, Eve took the fruit and ate of it. And at that point, Adam should have stopped her. I think he should have said, wait, God said not to do this. She should have stopped. Now, we can see various things that lead up to their fall in the way in which Eve responded and so forth. And we can see errors that they were making. But until they disobeyed God's word specifically, I think they would not have been counted as being sinful until they disobeyed. And it, as the catechism says, what was the sin by which our first parents fell? Eating the forbidden fruit. Not their adding this to the command, or not this suggestion, or whatever they might have said, that would have been, we would see, well, that's we ought not to do that when we're tempted. That we can learn lessons from that. But the actual sin was the disobedience of God, and disobedience against God's word. And you have then their falling, and immediately, whereas they had not been ashamed of themselves and of their own bodies, they become ashamed. The very thing that they thought they were going to gain, knowledge, they really gain shame. Guilt is what they got. As immediately, and both of them are ashamed of their bodies now. The very thing that they've been made for now has become something that's shameful. And it's interesting to read from that end of the second chapter. They were both naked down through the seventh verse of the next chapter, where it says they now saw that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, as you look at this and they hear the voice of Jehovah God walking in the garden, they knew who he was. This suggests that they'd already had fellowship with him in that personal way of his coming in the garden, speaking to them, and so forth. And now as they hear him coming, what do they want to do? Sinners want to rush to God and be saved. That's what we hear so often. Evangelists telling us, people are just hungry for the gospel. What do they want to do? Hide. They did not want to face God. And that's the essential attitude of the sinful man. Until the Spirit of God changes his heart, he doesn't want to face God. He doesn't want to have anything to do with God. He doesn't want to go to heaven. He just wants to continue in his sin. And so you find them hiding from God. And God called them. They hid themselves from the presence of Jehovah God amongst the trees of the garden. And Jehovah God called unto the man and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldst not eat? Matthew Henry, in his commentary, has a very interesting suggestion on this. Here's the first judgment seat of God. Adam and Eve called before the judgment bar of God. Have you sinned? Have you done this thing that I told you not to do? And they have to confess that they have. And you see the depravity of their sins immediately. The man said, the woman whom thou hast given me. He's not only blaming the woman, he's blaming God. And that shows the total depravity that he fell into as he fell into sin. That he's not going to accept God as a benevolent God. He hates God now. And the woman whom thou hast given me, she gave me to eat, and I did eat. And Jehovah God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me. It's each one shifting the blame to someone else. And that, don't we see that continually today? Blame shifting. And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And Jehovah God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou cursed art thou above all the cattle, above every beast of the field, upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. Now what kind of change may have taken place with regard to the serpent, we just don't know. It sounds as though may have gone through some sort of change that he no longer is able to move in an upright position of some sort. But we just don't know. Only serpents that we know are always the ones that have crawled on their bellies. It could be even, if he was made that way, that this now becomes odious to him. Whereas prior to this, it was part of his nature and he accepted it without any problem. But now the calling upon his belly becomes an odious thing. Just as labor, which had been given to Adam originally, now becomes difficult. Childbirth, which had been given to the woman, originally is a good gift, now becomes painful. And so it may be that that's what is really reflected here, that he's going upon his belly. He may have been made that way already, but now it's going to be part of the curse upon him that he goes upon the belly as, in a sense, as an act of punishment to him. And then that next verse, a remarkable verse called the Proto-Evangelium. That is the first statement of the gospel. Notice who to whom God is saying this. I will put enmity between thee and the woman. He's talking to the serpent. Serpent's the object of his speech at this point. Adam and Eve, what are they doing? They're listening. They're hearing it. But they're not called upon to do anything other than believe it. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. And he shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. And it's quite clear in the Hebrew that it is a personal pronoun that is there, and it is not just it, but rather the it is he. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. And we understand that, and the Jews even see this as a messianic reference, a reference to the coming Messiah, that one who is going to be born of woman is going to be the one through whom redemption is going to come. Victory over Satan is going to come. So we speak of this as the proto-evangelium. It's really the first statement of the covenant of grace. And if you think about the parties, it's God and Christ as the second Adam, really. The catechism, the larger catechism, describes it this way in question 31. With whom was the covenant of grace made? The covenant of grace was made with Christ as the second Adam, and in him with all the elect as his seed. So it is with Christ and the elect. All his seed, the elect seed of his, that he is the federal head of the elect then. And so the covenant of grace then has these two parties. And what is involved in this? Again, the question 32 of the larger catechism. You don't have anything comparable to it in the confession or the shorter. How is the grace of God manifested in the second covenant? Grace of God is manifested in the second covenant in that he freely provideth and offereth to sinners a mediator. That's interesting. They've called him the head of the covenant, the party of the covenant. He's also the mediator of the covenant, Christ the mediator. Offereth to the sinners a mediator and life and salvation by him, requiring faith as the condition to interest them in him. So these elect who are involved must come to faith if they're going to have an interest in him. Promiseth and giveth his Holy Spirit to all his elect to work in them that faith with all other saving graces and to enable them unto all holy ordinances as the evidence of the truth of their faith and thankfulness to God and as the way which he hath appointed them to salvation. And so here you have then a summary of the gospel. What is this? God saying, and notice as you look at that Genesis 3:15 again, who does this? God. It's God initiated and God done. Adam didn't do it. Adam and Eve didn't do it at all. They were just simply bystanders at this point hearing this. I will put the enmity there. I will cause this to take place. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. And he, the ultimate seed of the woman, is going to bruise the head of the serpent, the death blow. And in doing so, he will be bruised. Now, the language actually bruising is not strong enough. Hebrew really suggests crush, the crushing of the head of the serpent. And he was crushed in doing so, of course, in the death upon the cross. And so you have then the covenant of grace announced there in that seed promise, the seed of the woman promise. And then he speaks to the woman, says that in pain she shall bear children. But the good news is you have, in a sense, from there here on, throughout the rest of Scripture, both judgment against the sin, but mercy also. She is going to bear children in pain, but she'll bear children. And the man, he's going to have to, by the sweat of his brow, bring forth his food from the earth in work and labor. He'll have the sweat of the brow. It's difficult for him to labor and so forth, but he'll be able to do it by the mercy of God, by the grace of God. And so you have that line, that double line going all the way on through that. And then at the end, you might ask the question, did Adam and Eve believe? Were they believers or not? You know, they're not listed in the catalog of the faithful in Hebrews 11. Begins with Abel and not with Adam. I think, though, that Adam and Eve did believe. Fact is, as you get down to verse 20, the man called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living. You see, he's believing this promise. There's going to be a seed. There's going to be children. And she's going to be the mother. And so he names her Eve. I think that's an indication of it. And perhaps even more strongly, chapter 4, verse 1, the man knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man with the help of Jehovah. She thought Cain was the seed. And so she believed in this promise, the seed. She was mistaken as to who it was going to be, but she believed the seed promise and was trusting that God was going to give them the victory in the end. And then after you have the murder by Abel of Abel by Cain, you have then in the end of chapter 4 and verse 25, and Adam knew his wife again, and he bare a son, and his name is Seth. And that means substitute. Substitute for Abel, who had been killed. They're still looking for that seed promise to come. And so we have, I think, evidence that they did believe the promise. They were trusting what God had said now was true, that they could have a victory by trusting in God's gracious promise of the seed of the woman and the victory that he was going to give. Now, one other thing I think that is worth noting, verse 21 of chapter 3, and Jehovah God made for Adam and for his wife coats of skin and clothed them. They had tried to clothe themselves. In a sense, it's a real picture. Men try to save themselves by their works, unable to do it. Adam and Eve could not cover themselves with fig leaves properly. God gives them a covering. But what was required? The death of those animals for the coats of skin. God took the death. The day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. What was required of Adam and Eve was death. And so God accepted the substitute, as it were, in order to clothe them. He himself provided that substitute in the animals that were slain in order to give them clothing. And again, I say, is a picture of the gospel. I think we must read in between the lines. We who believe, as Presbyterians do, in the regulative principle of worship, must believe that God gave a whole lot more information to Adam as to how he was to worship. The very next chapter opens with Abel bringing a sacrifice, a bloody sacrifice, one of his lambs. And Cain coming with the fruit of his own hands, as it were, out of the ground with no blood sacrifice. And I think that if Hebrews says, by faith Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And what is the difference? In part, I think it's the attitude of heart, of course, of the two. Abel brought and recognized he needed a substitute. The basis of all the sacrificial worship in the Old Testament, when you think about it, is here I am a sinner and I want to approach God. And I can't. But I give an unblemished lamb as my replacement, my substitute. And when I've given that, then I can look to God for blessing. The death penalty has to be paid. And as we will talk about this more under the Mosaic economy later, but as a sinner came and offered his lamb, he put his hands on the head of the lamb and confessed his sins, put his sins on the lamb. And as soon as that was done, the lamb's life was forfeited. He had to die. The imputing of his sins to the lamb, and then the lamb's death in the stead of the sinner, and the smoke rising to heaven, picture of God's acceptance of that sacrifice. And so I think we see that, as I say, you don't have that detail given. But Patrick Fairbairn, who was one of the Scottish theologians of the 19th century in the Free Church of Scotland, in a book called The Typology of Scripture, develops this idea that God, if we believe the regulative principle, God has always given men enough knowledge to know how to worship properly. That Adam and Eve must have known how to worship properly. They didn't just come up with this out of their own minds, but God told them to. And that this sacrificing of the animals in the garden may well have been part of the picture of that. God explained it to them, perhaps. We just don't have that language here. And then with Abel's first sacrifice being a bloody sacrifice, a substitute for himself. Now, those are the main things that I would want to talk about with regard to Adam. Let me, before moving to Abraham, I think Adam then would have been justified before the fall simply by God's declaring him to be righteous in his sight. After the fall, it's necessary that he be pardoned of his sins and then accepted as righteous, and then on the basis of the imputed righteousness of Christ. So the covenant of grace that's announced in the Genesis 3:15 is a picture and an announcement of the gospel that we now hold with much more knowledge about it from the New Testament, of course. But let me pause and let you ask questions or give comment or at this point if any of you have questions on this. I know this is very familiar material for you, but I think it's useful to go back over it again. Yes, sir. I think we have to see that that was a genuine probation, and had Adam obeyed, that he would have genuinely been rewarded for his obedience. Now, I don't think it's problematical in the sense of what is God's decree. God's decreed that he's not going to obey. That's not to say that Adam is not guilty. Adam is the one who does the sinning, and therefore he's entirely guilty of it. But the decree of God, Deuteronomy 29:29, such a helpful verse. The secret things belong to the Lord our God. What God has decreed with regard to that probation, we don't know until after it takes place. Once it has taken place, and John Gerstner used to say this, once something has taken place, then you'd have to say, and I wouldn't have it any other way. That's difficult to say. You have a child that dies in childbirth, and you'd say, I wouldn't have it any other way. Can you really say that? If you believe that God works all things together for your good, ultimately you will be able to say it. Might not be able to say it at the moment, but ultimately you'll be able to say it. So, but we don't. Adam would not have known, and we would, if we were standing there, would not know what God had decreed with regard to that probation. The secret decree is that Adam was going to sin. The preceptive will of God was, Adam, you should not eat. So we live by the precepts, not by the decrees. The laws of God, you see, are what we live by, are not by the decrees, the secret things of God. So we don't know who the elect are and so forth, but we then simply obey God and preach his word to the whole world, whosoever will may come. All right, anything else? I failed to respond, to give that question for the tape. Yes, sir.
Well,
Question is whether the righteousness and the forgiveness of sin are the same, or are there differences in them, or what is the relation to them. What I'm citing, of course, is the catechism question of definition of justification. It is the act, free act of God whereby he pardoneth all of our sins, and that would be one point. And then also accepts us as righteous. And it's as the result of the pardoning that he can accept us as righteous. I think they are different. In other words, they are two different aspects of justification. So that's why I suggest Adam, prior to the fall, all you had to say, being accepted as righteous in God's sight would be justification, his justification prior to the fall. No pardon required because he hadn't sinned. Once sin enters the picture, the first thing that's needed is pardon. And then whether God will accept us as righteous or not. And that on the basis, of course, Christ imputed righteousness. Yes, righteousness would be beyond the forgiveness by itself. In other words, I think to say that justification is just the forgiving of our sins is not full enough statement with regard to justification. That it's a much richer concept. It is the forgiveness, but it also is God's accepting me as righteous in his sight. Clothes me with the righteousness of Christ. And it's a much richer concept than just to say, define justification in terms of forgiveness. I think that's a very good question. And there are some branches in the Christian church that don't quite see that matter of the acceptance of righteousness. I remember I was asked once, one of the encyclopedias or dictionaries or something, they asked me when I was still teaching at Reformed Seminary what I thought ought to be included in definition of justification. And I said, you need both the forgiveness and the acceptance of righteousness as righteous. And I don't think they came up with that. I think there were too many people that objected to it because they only saw forgiveness as being involved in justification. All right. Yes, sir. Oh, and that's the constitutive act. It's the righteousness of Christ. The question is whether there has to be genuine righteousness of God. Yes, absolutely. And it's the constitutive act in which God imputes to us the righteousness of Christ. And when you use that language, imputation or impute, all we are saying, he reckons it to our account. He counts us as having it. And absolutely. And I think that where some of the confusion is coming today in some of the so-called controversy over justification is their failure to recognize that that's different from what Rome says. Rome says with regard to justification that justification takes place at baptism. And what happens is God forgives the past sins and infuses righteousness into men and enables them then to live godly lives. Now, not perfectly. And so as they live along and they've fallen into some sin, then they have to go to confession and make confession, and then they have to do penance, which is in a sense saying, okay, my baptism didn't quite cover everything. Since baptism, I've done some sinning. Baptism didn't cover everything. Now I try to cover it with doing penance. And in the final rite, as you finally come down to your death and you're asked for a final confession, and then you see the final rite is in a sense trying to extend the baptism to the very end of life. But Rome recognizes on their basis no man's been able to live it perfectly. Therefore, or like I say, I guess their saints would, those whom they recognize to be saints would, but men, ordinary men, don't live it perfectly, therefore they have to go to purgatory to purge out their sin. To finish paying for it. What Christ didn't do, I've got to do. And you see, it's an attack upon the heart of the gospel. Our concept is that, as we sing in one of our hymns, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. And that we believe that he truly gained salvation for us. Earned it for us. Paid the full price. Whereas Rome is saying, and one of the controversies between Rome and the Protestants was, Rome says, no assurance of salvation. You have to go to purgatory before you're going to finally end up coming out of that. No assurance, and the Protestants were saying, I wish I had the Heidelberg with me. That first question of the Heidelberg speaks about what is your only comfort in life and death, and it's that fact that you have salvation now. The note of assurance, as it was stated in the Heidelberg Catechism in the very first question. Protestants believe we could have assurance of salvation. Now, as the Westminster Divines developed that more later, they see a difference between saving faith, not necessarily involving immediate assurance, and assurance that I have saving faith. So there's a distinction between the act of believing in Christ as Savior and the confidence that I have truly believed. And you get into that question that sort of assurance is based on the promises of God, the evidences of in your life, and the testimony of the Holy Spirit that you're one of the children of God. And as you look up that chapter on assurance, and you'll see that those are the three things that the Protestant or Westminster standards do see. But that was one of the great difficulties. Now, I was going back to say, Rome says that justification is by infusion of grace. The Westminster Confession, and you'll have this in your hymn book, in the Confession is chapter 11, paragraph 1. Those whom God effectually calls, he also freely justifieth, not by infusing righteousness into them, but by pardoning their sins, and by accounting and accepting their persons as righteous, not for anything wrought in them or done by them, but for Christ's sake alone. The ground of our justification is Christ and Christ's work, not anything that we do. And this is one of the problems that some of the modern views have gotten into, raising that question. Not by imputing faith itself. You know, I get to talking about Abraham, I want to talk about that phrase. Not by imputing faith itself, the act of believing or any other evangelical obedience to them as their righteousness, but by imputing the obedience and satisfaction of Christ unto them, they receiving and resting on him and his righteousness by faith, which faith they have not of themselves, it is the gift of God. That's a great statement when you think and begin to analyze it and think about it. Chapter 11, paragraph 1. Are there any other questions that I want to try to move on, if we can, to Abraham? Yes, sir. Just that he's described as more subtle, but what does that mean? I'm not sure. And the fact is, Eve should have been put on her guard, and if Adam was there, he should have been put her on guard too. But none of the other animals can speak. How come this serpent can speak? He should have said, wait, there's something wrong here. But Adam doesn't exercise his own sovereignty at that point over Eve, his own authority over her. Doesn't call her and say, wait, don't listen to him. But this was their whole experience in the garden, of course, was new, and they just presumably assumed that this would be something that was just part of the newness of the garden. But all we are told in the Bible is that the serpent is more subtle. But what does that mean? Would lions not be subtle? Presumably not. But serpents are sneaky, as it were. And I think we tend to think of them that way. And that would seem to be the reason that Satan chooses that. He might have chosen any other animal and have done it through that. But it is in the record, that's what we have. Curiosity killed the cat. First example of it. I'm not sure. With regard to Eve, what the thing that the final temptation with regard to her is the matter of pride. If you eat of this tree, you'll be like God. And there's that appeal to pride, and it continues to be one of those besetting sins for all of us. Pride is one of the natural things. We have egos. We like to be praised. We have a pride, and it's a natural thing. And your children like to be praised, and so forth. And it's a natural thing for us on the one hand, but she allows that to get in the way. and is tempted with the pride as the means by which she finally falls. It's interesting, Paul and Timothy speaks about her being deceived, but Adam not being deceived. Adam seemed to have fully recognized that what he was doing was disobedience to God. She deceived, not thinking that in those terms, is deceived. And it's very interesting. It's Adam's sin, not Eve's sin, that we are held accountable for. Adam, you see, was the head of the race. He's the federal head, not Eve. She sinned first. But Adam is the one who voluntarily disobeys and defies God in his sin. And you can see the results immediately with his own accusing of God and giving to him the woman. And then further in his children. First two children. One murders the other. The depravity of men seen immediately after that. All right, let me move on. Chapter 6 verse 5 talks about, we've talked about the depravity of men. Jehovah saw that the wickedness of men was great in the earth, that every imagination of the thoughts of the heart was only evil continually. That was a description of the human race prior to the flood. I submit to you it's a description of the human race today, though, except for those who have been touched by the Holy Spirit and drawn to Christ. Every man is sinful by nature, and his thoughts are only evil continually. Every imagination of the thoughts of his heart, only evil continually. And you listen to the television, you wonder, why do people do this? Why do children kill other children? Every imagination of the thoughts of the heart is only evil continually. Men are depraved by in heart. I like Roger Nicole suggests, instead of total depravity, it's radical depravity. It's root depravity. It's heart depravity. That really is what the Bible describes. And along with that, Romans 8:7 says, the natural man cannot please God. Total inability for man to come to God. Now, in the sovereignty of God after the flood, God called a man named Abram in chapter 12, in verse 1. Now Jehovah said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house into a land that I will show thee. Now, let me just take a moment quickly to sketch this. Where he was. He was in Ur of the Chaldees, which is way down in the Tigris and Euphrates valleys. And if we can think of the Euphrates and the Tigris, Ur is down here. Babylon would be about here. And what he does at first is move up and then stops here and names that place Haran. And then as they comes over and you have the Sea of Galilee and then the Dead Sea, eventually comes down into this land that God shows him. But he didn't know where he was going. But this part of the world at that period was as educated and cultured, if not more so, than Egypt. They developed much more complex language with the cuneiform, much more complex than hieroglyphics. And I think it's much higher culture in some ways. Now, the reason we don't have the great remnants is because it was in a floodplain. It's constantly flooded. They built their ziggurat towers, their worship towers, out of clay and brick. And these were essentially the lost with floods that came over that region. Whereas the Egyptians used stone in a more dry, a drier country. And that's the reason so much of that has been preserved. But what Abram is called to do is to leave America and go to some wilderness place in the world that I'll show you. That's what he's called, to leave the very best culture that there was with all the computers and everything and go to wherever I take you. And he is called to do it by faith. Simply listen, obey. Jehovah said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country. From thy kindred, he's leave his family, and from thy father's house unto the land that I will show thee, and I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and be thou a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee, and him that curseth thee will I curse, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, to get the import and the impact of that, need to turn to Galatians, where Paul, in chapter 3, speaking about Abram, in verse 6, even as Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him unto him for righteousness, know therefore that they that are of the faith are the same as are the sons of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. So it picks up that verse out of chapter 12, and Paul says, that's the gospel. It's the good news that God is bringing a salvation that's going to go far beyond just Abraham and his ethnic seed, his own people. It's going to bless the whole world. And we are here tonight, all of us, virtually all of us, of Gentile background. We're here because the fulfillment of that promise, that we are blessed because of that. So we have Abraham doing it. He does it not perfectly, but in the 15th chapter, you have the announcement again of God coming to him before him again. After these things, the word of Jehovah came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram. I am thy shield and exceeding great reward. Now, they, after these things, need to go back really and read 14th chapter, where Abram has gone out and fought the battle with the kings that had taken this Sodom and Gomorrah and taken them captive. And Abram goes out and wins the battle and of course, saves his nephew Lot. And Melchizedek meets him and feeds him, and he then gives a tithe to Melchizedek. So it's after a battle, and God says unto him, I am thy exceeding great reward. Abram has refused any booty from that battle. Ordinarily, soldiers would take portions of it. And God says, I'm your reward. You don't have to worry about not getting some physical loot out of that battle. I'm your exceeding great reward. When you think about it, that's an absolutely amazing statement. And you think about the gospel. That's what we have in the gospel. God is our exceeding great reward. You can't ask for anything more. There isn't anything bigger or greater than that. That God is our reward. And yet, as you look at Abram, he's still thinking about the fact, I'm childless. You said I'm going to be a blessing to the whole world, and I don't even have a child yet. And I've been in this land now for a number of years, and I don't have a child. Abram said, oh, Lord Jehovah, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless? God just finished saying, I'll give you myself. But he's worried about being childless. And Abram said, O Lord Jehovah, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless? And he that shall be possessor of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. That's his own servant. And this was the general law of that period. That if a man died without his own seed and he had a servant that was in his household, he would inherit. And so he's saying Eliezer is going to become the inheritor. And behold, the word of Jehovah came unto him, saying, this man shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad, and you think about in the Middle East and that dry country and the beauty of the darkness and of the night. And he brought him forth abroad, and he said, look now toward heaven and number the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in Jehovah, and he reckoned it to him for righteousness. Now, Candlish, who was another free church pastor and wrote a theologian, he wrote a commentary on the book of Genesis. He says that it probably and can be translated this way, is not that the faith is reckoned to him, but righteousness is reckoned to him. And as I was giving this lecture or a similar lecture in Greenville recently, Dr. Shaw, who's our Old Testament professor, was there in the audience, and he went and double-checked the Hebrew, and he says, that is a perfectly good translation. That it's not the faith that is reckoned to him, but righteousness is reckoned to him. Now, that fits with our whole understanding, just what we have in our catechism question. That's the righteousness of God. righteousness of Christ that's reckoned to us and received by faith alone. Here's the first case in the scripture of this reference to faith and a reference to believing. He believed in God, and God reckoned it to him for righteousness. And so he believing what? This promise. You're not going to go childless. Your own bowels are going to produce this child and this seed, this family that's going to be so many as the sand upon the seashore and as the stars in the heavens. And Abraham then said in verse 8, and he said, O Lord Jehovah, whereby shall I know that I shall inherit it? Said unto him, take me a heifer 3 years old, she-goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He took him all of these and divided them. Now, the interesting language in the Hebrew with regard to making covenants is that the verb is they cut a covenant. And it's based upon this. And I don't have time to go to it, but if Jeremiah 34, verse 18 and 19, you find the Israelites being held accountable. They had passed through between the pieces of covenant-making animals that had been sacrificed. And they are held to the death penalty. That's what they're taking upon themselves, the death penalty, when they pass through between the animals that have been slain. And so here you have God making a covenant with Abraham with regard to the fact that he's going to take the children, his seed, down into Egypt, but he will bring them back again. When verse 12, when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto him, Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them for 100 years, and also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward they shall come out with great substance. But thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace and be buried in good old age. Verse 17, and it came to pass, when the sun went down, and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a flaming torch that passed between these pieces. Now, that's strange sort of language. What they are, and it's a theophany, an impersonal theophany. In the Exodus, you find God appearing in an impersonal theophany to Moses in the burning bush. Here's a flaming torch passing between these pieces. It's God. It's a theophany. That's an appearance of God. And what's he doing? He's taking the penalty of that covenant upon himself. And ultimately, we see in the gospel, the Lord Jesus, who took that penalty and paid it. Not that he broke it, but we've broken it. And he paid our broken covenant, paid for our broken covenant with his death. And you see God here then passing between the pieces and in a sense swearing by his doing so that he's going to bring to pass this event. And so you have then Abraham, the entering into the covenant, the 17th chapter, you have more specifically the covenant promise, I'll be a God unto thee, unto thy seed after thee, in verse 7 of chapter 17. And then the beautiful picture of the salvation that is given in the offering up of Isaac. And you find in the 22nd chapter, after Abraham is ready to kill his son, and God stops him. And verse 12, and he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in the thicket by his thorns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. There you have this idea of a substitutionary sacrifice. Substitution of the ram instead of Isaac. Isaac was on the death penalty, under a death penalty. As a sinner, he deserved it. And God spares him as he lets that ram be offered in his stead. And so you have a beautiful picture of the substitutionary atonement idea. And then the angel of Jehovah, and this is again a theophany, the angel of Jehovah called unto Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, saith Jehovah, because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thee, thy seed as the stars of the heavens and as the sand which is upon the seashore. Thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. That's that victory note that had been given in Genesis 3:15. It's now not just the seed of the woman, it's the seed of Abraham. And ultimately we know that seed to be the Lord Jesus is the one who came and gained that victory. So as you think about Abraham's justification, it was justification by faith. He believed that promise, and God reckoned righteousness to him on the ground of the fact that he believed it. Now, it's not, I shouldn't say it that way. The grounds are ultimately is the righteousness of God to do it. But the instrument by which he receives it is by faith. He believed what God had shown him that night in the stars, and he believed that God was going to give him a seed. Now, sad to say, in that next chapter, the 16th chapter of Genesis, Sarah says, well, I'm not having children. Take Hagar and have it. And you have that attempt by Abraham and Sarah to bring about this thing on their own. And you have the Ishmaelites raised up as a result. That enmity is still going on right today in Palestine today with the Israelites and the Ishmaelites still there fighting with each other. But the justification by faith alone is one of the great notes that you have. Paul picks up on that in Romans 4 and cites that verse to point out, and we'll be talking about this perhaps a little bit more, a little further on, cites this verse that Abraham believed God, saying justification has always been justification by faith alone. The Jews were saying, oh no, it's been by works. And Paul is saying, oh no, it's always been by faith. Now, I know our time is almost up, but maybe we have a question or two. Yes?
Would you define justifying faith?
I will define it by reading the catechism.
Okay.
The larger catechism defines it, justifying faith is a saving grace wrought in the heart of a sinner by the Spirit and Word of God, whereby he being convinced of his sin and misery. Now, if you're familiar with the question on effectual calling, this is repeating. What's effectual calling? Convincing us of our sin and misery? Enlightening our minds in the knowledge of Christ? He doth persuade, him, renewing our wills, he doth persuade and enable us to embrace Jesus as he's offered in the gospel. So this larger catechism, whereby being convinced of his sin and misery, and of the disability in himself and all other creatures to recover him out of his lost condition, not only assenteth to the truth. In other words, I believe this is a bench. I believe it's strong enough to hold me, but until I've sat upon it, I haven't trusted it. And it's the trusting that's involved in particular in saving faith. Receiveth and resteth upon Christ and his righteousness. The questions we ask as a person being received and admitted to the Lord's table, you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner. Do you believe Jesus is the Son of God? And do you rest upon him alone for your salvation? That's the idea of trusting. It's not just intellectual acceptance. Intellect is involved. But it's the commitment. Casting oneself upon Christ and upon him alone for your salvation. Resting upon Christ and his righteousness, therein held forth for pardon of sin, for the accepting and accounting of his person righteous in the sight of God for salvation. So I think that your larger catechism is so helpful on some of these questions. I'm sorry it's not in our hymn book, but it's part of our standards. All right, anything else? Yes, sir. Since the tape is running, let me let you get that question. I've got one more back here, and then I'll come right back to you. Yes, sir. Try. I think we can. I think that what we have Justification in general in would be in Deuteronomy 25:1 would be a good classic verse to look at, and I perhaps should have had this at the very beginning. The question of whether justification involves just the action or involves also some activity beyond that. If Deuteronomy 25:1, if there be a controversy between men and they come into judgment and the judge judges them, then they that shall justify the righteous and condemn the wicked. And there is strictly the forensic idea of the judge declaring, this man is not guilty, he's righteous in the sight of this court, this man is guilty, condemned by the court. And in a sense, we get our concept of justification in the contrast between justifying and condemning. And that's one of the clearest passages. Now, you do have in the scripture passages that also speak of God's judgment that does involve actually carrying out the judgment. And fact is, in this very section, when it talks about the wicked, it goes on to talk about how many stripes are to be given to the wicked. So the matter of a forensic declaration on the one hand may well be followed by further activity on the part of the judge in that case. And I think that's getting to the question that you're asking. So the Bible does have these different usages. And I would say if you look at the Westminster Standards with regard to justification, the second paragraph says, faith thus receiving and return, resting on Christ and his righteousness is the alone instrument of justification, yet it is not alone in the person justified, but is ever accompanied with all other saving graces, and is no dead faith, but worketh by love. We would define justification as the act of declaration of forgiveness, but immediately growing out of the rebirth is sanctification. What Rome is doing is, in a sense, putting these two together and saying that's justification. Whereas I think the Protestant understanding of distinguishing this is justification is the act, the forensic declaration of one being righteous. Whereas immediately, it starts really, the sanctification starts with the rebirth. In fact, is you can't come to faith until you've had the rebirth. Faith is the gift of God. How do you get that gift? God gives you a new heart. Child Catechism, by the way, is so good on this. Who can change the sinner's heart? Holy Spirit alone. Nobody else. I can't change it. Preacher can't change it. Teacher can't change it. Parent can't change it. Child can't change it. The Holy Spirit alone is. He's the one who gives the new heart. But with that new heart, first act that the regenerate man does as he sees and hears the gospel, to receive it, believe it, he's justified, and immediately he's in the process of sanctification. And I think part of the problem of some of the controversy today is the confusing and putting these together again, as Rome did. Maybe not in exactly the same terms that Rome did, but it's a similar sort of thing. Yes, sir, your question. The question is whether this is true, whether man tells, when God makes a promise, man doesn't want to let it be a promise, he wants to work for it. And I think that is generally true. Man, by his sinful nature, and that pride that's part of that sinful nature, says, I don't have to have somebody do it for me, I can do it for myself. And there's a natural tendency for us to want to be able to earn for ourselves salvation or the promises. But with regard to the gospel, it ultimately has to be. And this is one of the things that's beautiful about the gospel. It's very humbling. We believe in election and so forth, but it's very humbling to realize it's all of God and nothing of me. Well, I think our time is about up. I'm sure our tape is just about run out. So let's close with prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for Thy word. We thank Thee for these figures that we've looked at, Adam, and then as we looked at Abraham, to recognize on the one hand Adam's possibility of having kept that covenant of works, but then the sad message of his failure. But Thy gracious dealing, even from the beginning, of giving that seed promise that thou would give a victory over the serpent and over sin and over death and over hell. And we see Abraham believing thy promise that you would provide a seed for him, and thou didst impute to him the righteousness of Christ that he might be justified. And how thankful we are that that's the case, and it's the case for us as well, as we trust in Christ, that we receive the righteousness of Christ and the forgiveness of our sins to be justified in thy sight forever. Bless these thoughts to our hearts. Go with us to our homes this evening. Give us a good night's rest and a good day tomorrow. And we ask it in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
In just a couple of minutes, and now, the stuff that you need to pick up, not do it right up here on the front pew. Please take one. You will not understand what Dr. Jude is talking about for the second, or which session is that going to be?
Second section.
The second session, unless you read this. So I encourage you to take it up and get an idea. Then, secondly, by 8:30, if you haven't had breakfast, you can have breakfast here. It will be a very common number. So, I mean, you'll be stuck in these.